Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome. It's a great pleasure to introduce our speaker for tonight, Emeritus Professor Jean-Claude Theis, who's had a long career as a very well-known orthopaedic surgeon at Dunedin Hospital, but now, since retirement, I believe, is essentially doing charity surgical orthopaedic work in various places in the world. I think some of them are up here, Malawi, Philippines. Jean-Claude, where are you heading off to this year?
Next week I'm going to the Philippines, and then in May I'm going back to Malawi.
Right. So, I mean, that's another talk in itself. Yeah. Anyway, it's a great pleasure this evening to have Jean-Claude talking about military physical orthopedics. So,
Thank you, Terry. Very much. Thanks, Terry, for your introduction, and good afternoon, everybody. I think the topic of my talk is very opportune today. It's the 23rd of February. It's the anniversary of the invasion of Ukraine by the Russian military. First of all, I dedicate this talk to two people, my late father, Albert. Here you can see him in his police uniform. He was in the police force when the Germans invaded my home country, Luxembourg, in 1940. And then he was forced and conscripted into the German army, had to fight for the Germans in Yugoslavia, and then was asked to swear allegiance to Hitler, which he refused. He was arrested and was imprisoned in a concentration camp in Dachau near Munich for 2 years. Unfortunately, survived. So that's my, after the war, he became an officer in the Luxembourgish army. So that's my military background. And then on the right-hand side, everybody knows the late Professor Keith Jeffrey, who's interested me in the history of orthopedics. And this book here is the book which really inspired me to do this topic, this talk. This was given to me by a senior orthopedic nurse, Elaine Godman. I think she's still on the ward, she still works. I'm not sure where she got the book from, but I read it and I got sort of inspired. And it was written by this chap here, Dr. Arthur Stanley Herbert. And it was called Military Physical Orthopedics. It was published in 1918. And he was basically sort of one of the first rehabilitation physicians looking after the wounded New Zealand soldiers when they returned to New Zealand. And I come back to him later on. The other person I want to talk tonight is actually an injured New Zealand soldier, Alfred Charles Piper. You see this young man with his wing-tipped collar there and his pince-nez glasses. He's actually my wife's grandfather, and I will come back to him later on as well. Now, we know the Great War was really the first true world war. Why is it called the Great War? I don't know, because it encompassed, it sort of involved the whole world, or because the number of casualties. You can see it was a tragic war. There was 9 million soldiers from both sides of the conflict killed in combat. And there was a huge number of wounded, 23 million. And there was also some civilians killed, 5 million, although the numbers vary depending on what you read. So we probably don't know exactly how many were killed. Now, how did it all start? Well, it started with the assassination of the Archduke Franz Ferdinand in Sarajevo. Now, Archduke Franz Ferdinand was the heir to the throne of the Austria-Hungary Empire. He was actually the son of our friend Joseph, after which the glacier on the west coast is named. And he was assassinated by a Bosnian Serb because Austria-Hungary had invaded Bosnia and were occupying Bosnia. And that's the reason why he was assassinated. And the war between Austria-Hungary and Serbia was declared on the 28th of July 1914. Now, the Russians came to the help of the Serbians, and then the two sides of the war formed themselves. I mean, there was the allied powers. It was France, the UK, Russia, Italy, and Japan on one side, and on the other side there was called the Central Powers, mainly Germany, Austria-Hungary, and the Ottoman Empire, which was basically Turkey. Now, the reason I believe why it became a world war is because all the colonies of these countries became involved as well. France had colonies in Africa, the UK had colonies over the world, Russia didn't really have any colonies, Italy didn't have any, nor Japan. And it's interesting, Italy was on the side of the Allied powers, mainly because Austria and Hungary had occupied some parts of northern Italy, and they thought, if we're with the Allied powers, we can recoup those territories. And the fighting occurred, as you know, it started in Europe, but then spread to the Middle East, Africa, the Pacific, and part of Asia. Now, this is a map of Europe in 1914. It's a bit complicated, but you can see that the fights were happening on a number of fronts. We all know about the Gallipoli campaign here, which the New Zealanders were involved quite a lot, and that was in relation to this sea strait, the Dardanelles, which separate Europe from Asia, and that was a strategic point here, because that gives access to the Black Sea via the Dardanelles, and the center is the Sea of Marmara and then the Bosphorus. So there was also the Russians had two fronts, actually. They had a front here, the Eastern Front, and they had a front here in the Caucasus where they were fighting the Turks, the Ottoman Empire. The British were also fighting the Turks in Mesopotamia, which is basically Iraq, and then there was a Palestinian campaign. But the main fronts where the New Zealanders were involved was the Dardanelles, the Gallipoli, and then the Western Front later on. Now, Britain declared war against Germany in August 1914, and then straight away the Empire called the colonies for, we need men, and they called Australia, Canada, India, and New Zealand, as you can see there, and they all responded. And the New Zealand Expeditionary Force actually got involved in the war very early. Now, New Zealand had a territorial army. That means they couldn't be deployed overseas because they had to defend their home country. So they had to call for volunteers, and they got lots of them. Lots of New Zealanders and Australians, and I'm sure Canadians and others volunteered to fight for the empire. And the first contingent, New Zealand contingent of about 8,500 men left New Zealand in October 1914, so very early. And they were joined by the Australian Imperial Army, and that's where the ANZAC Army Corps was formed in 1914. And the New Zealand force was commanded, the commander was Alexander Godley, and he's quite well known here in New Zealand for what he's done in the First World War. But the overall Gallipoli commander of the New Zealand and the Australian army was a British guy called William Birdwood. And the New Zealanders, as well as the Australians, were active in Gallipoli, the Western Front, Egypt, and Palestine. Now, interestingly, the first military actions were actually in the Pacific. And the New Zealanders were involved first, and that was in August 1914. The British told the New Zealand government there is a wireless station in German Samoa. Samoa was occupied by the Germans, and they were concerned that wireless station would be able to transmit some information of what's going on in the Pacific to the German headquarters. So New Zealand sent out a Samoa expeditionary force to Samoa, about 1,500 men, and there was no, they took that easy, and there was no resistance from the Germans. And the Australians on their side, they went to the Germans. They had German New Guinea, and they went there and occupied the Bismarck Islands a little bit later on. Now, just a little anecdote, because you see, and I've been working in Malawi, and I've actually traveled on Lake Malawi in some very old ships there. One was built in 1951 in Scotland, and he's still plying the waters of Lake Malawi. So actually the first battle of World War I was actually on Lake Malawi, interestingly. And I've got an anecdote there. So between the 13th and 14th of August, 1914, and there was between two ships here. This was SS Gwendoline, was the British ship. And this one here was the Hermann von Wissmann, was a German ship, because the Germans were on Lake Malawi because of East Africa, which is now Tanzania, was occupied by the German. That was a German colony, as was Southwest Africa, which became Namibia. And then there was Cameroon, and there was Togo as well, belonged to the Germans. So actually these two old steamships, they were there before the World War as an anti-slave sort of boats, where they're trying to catch the slavers, which were in the slave trade. And the captains of the two boats knew each other. But when war broke out, the British sent a cable to the captain of the British ship and said, you need to go and attack that, destroy the German ship. So of course they went. They had to find somebody to operate the cannon, because it was a Hotchkiss cannon, and they found somebody. They had to find some shells as well. They found some as well, and then off they went. And they found a German ship, which was on the beach in a slipway being repaired. So they basically was easy. So they got the cannons ready and managed to disable and destroy the ship whilst it wasn't even in the water. And then they saw a man sort of running down the beach in his jacket and shorts in a rowing boat, rowing towards the British ship. And he was shouting and he was angry and upset. And that was the captain of the German ship. And he said, Gottverdammt, what are you doing? And the Brit said, oh, have you not heard? We are at war. And the German ship said, no, I didn't know. Nobody told me. And then the British guy said, you are now a prisoner. Come on board and we have a glass of whiskey. And that's what they did, because they were actually drinking friends from before the war, and they knew each other. I thought that was a nice anecdote. Anyway, so we all know about Gallipoli, the Dardanelles here, as you can see. And Lemnos was an important island there. It belonged to the Greeks. So the Anzac used that as their base to be able to ferry soldiers across to Gallipoli. And there was also a field hospital there. And then the Western Front, you also know about that, mainly sort of Northern France and the Eastern part of Belgium. And that's where quite a number of battles were fought. The Gallipoli campaign lasted about a year, and it was for the control of the Dardanelles, that sort of shipping strait there. And it was basically to support the Russians, because the Allies thought that if we defeat the Turks, that will make it easier for the Russians to fight on the Caucasus front. And also it was important for access to the Black Sea ports. The Russian Navy was based in Sevastopol, which is in the Black Sea. However, as we all know, it was a poorly planned campaign under the British General Sir Ian Hamilton. And there was a lack of troops, ammunition, and supplies. And it was really a deadly battle. 250,000 casualties on both sides, allies 130,000 dead, New Zealand casualties 8,000, including almost 3,000 dead. Now, that was not a good start for the war. But then if you look at the total injury and death rate for the New Zealanders, now 100,000 embarked, that was a lot. The population of New Zealand at that stage was 1 million. So that was 10% of the population. And that included 385 doctors, which was half of the doctors. There were only about 700 doctors in New Zealand, and there were also 550 nurses. Now 15%, about 15,000 of those 100,000 died. They were all young men and women, and 50,000 were wounded. And of course, these wounded had to be taken care of whilst during the conflict, but also after the conflict when they returned to New Zealand. And a lot of them couldn't carry on fighting. They had to be sent back to New Zealand and were treated for ongoing treatment. And they were mainly, the wounds were mainly artillery wounds, affecting mainly the limbs and the face, because there was only about 15% of the those who were injured had injuries to the torso and the abdomen, because those probably didn't make it and died before they reached the hospital. Here's just a breakdown of the death of the members of the New Zealand Expeditionary Force. You can see Gallipoli, France, and Belgium. Well, that was the most disastrous here, 12,000. Gallipoli was about 2,700. And some died in Palestine, Egypt. And then there were also about 1,000 died after discharge from the army. And there were about 500 died before they actually got to the war while training in New Zealand. And here's here you see the total casualty. Here you see the wounded and those who died. And you can see how the number went up. Started with Gallipoli, then the Somme, Messines, and Passchendaele. Now the Somme was the deadliest battle. The British in the first day of battle, they lost between 50 and 60,000 soldiers dead. So that was terrible. Now, what sort of injuries were the doctors seeing? Well, there were some head injuries. Now, initially, the soldiers didn't wear a helmet. There was no protection. But then in 1915, they wore the Brodie helmet, and I'll show you that in a moment. I already said that gunshot wounds to the torso and the abdomen were not recorded very often because they didn't make it. So they were mainly injuries to the legs, and then there were other things like the trench foot and also some other injuries. This is the Brodie helmet, which was worn by the Allies. Not a lot of protection for the face, and it looks a little bit wobbly on this chap's head there. It looks like it's about to come off. Now, the weaponry used, it was mainly in the artillery war. The Navy was mainly used for blockades, to block the German ports, so they couldn't get their navy out. However, they managed to get there. They had some boats around the oceans just when the war was declared, and they had quite a number of submarines as well. And the Air Force also wasn't very well developed, so it was mainly rifles, machine guns, mortars. The Germans had mobile howitzers, the British had the 18-pound field gun, and then there were flamethrowers and gas. I think Matthew Zacharias gave a talk on on that last year. So here we can see that somebody in the trench here, or the trench warfare on the Western Front, with a gun there. This is a machine gun with the Scotsman, Mrs. Tamashanta here, and then a field gun. And they had some early tanks. You can see there, it's a very primitive sort of tank. It's got some guns there on the side, but it seems to be used mainly as transport for the soldiers. And you know, artillery shells are interesting because basically they have shrapnel inside, okay, and then they can either be detonated by a time fuse, so the soldier has to set the time, and then it will explode above the artillery of your enemy and inflict some shrapnel wounds, or it can also be set so it impacts on impact. So when you're dealing with limb injuries caused by this weaponry, you have to distinguish between high and low energies, completely different. You have to think about entry wound and exit wound. Sometimes the entry wound is very small and the exit wound is quite significant. There's this issue as the bullet goes through the leg, there's a temporary cavity. I will talk about indirect fracture and the effect of clothing and the wound contamination. Now, I had a PhD student some years ago, David Kieser, who did his PhD thesis on gunshot wounds. And that was quite interesting because I didn't know a lot about it, but I knew a lot about it at the end of his PhD research. So low velocity is basically projectiles traveling at less than 350 meters per second. So that's about the speed of sound. But the high velocity above 600 meters per second is the ones which give the serious injuries. And that's about the speed of a fighter jet. Now on the left-hand side here, you can see a deer FEMA being shot by a high velocity 0.223 bullet at close range. And you can see the kinetic energy from that bullet is transmitted to the bone. And the kinetic energy is basically mass multiplied by velocity, square of velocity. So if you double the mass, you double the kinetic energy, but if you double the speed, you quadruple the kinetic energy. And we did that work. Here's some CT, micro CT of the of a deer femur. In a low velocity, you get very little. You get an indentation and maybe some undisplaced fractures, sometimes a little bit more, as you can see there. That's the bullet hitting the femur directly. In a flat bone, it's a bit different. Now here the diagram shows a round-tipped a bullet entering, and as it enters, it deforms, as you can see. So the caliber of the projectiles is increasing, and that's why the exit wound is much bigger than the entry wound. And this is illustrated here. We've got some sheep ribs here. We shot them. This is the entry wound. And then if you look at the underside, you take the periosteum away, you can see this big hole in the bone there. So we published a few of those things, and published mainly on indirect femoral fracture. That's where the bullet goes through the thigh without touching the bone, but causes a fracture. And we use this deer femurs, and we put them into gelatin, 20% gelatin, to represent the soft tissues of the thigh, and then shot through the gelatin. And you can see here's the entry, and there's the exit. And as the bullet enters, it forms a cavity which expands, which will increase the pressure and which will bend the bone, and the bone will break. And depending on the velocity and the mass of the bullet, you get worse fractures. Here's one you can see is much more comminuted, and this was a different caliber bullet. And then we also, we thought, what's the effect of clothing so on those fractures? And we used the same diaphemus in gelatine, but then we put some denim cloth on the surface and then shot through, I think we used cheap. And that makes the injury worse. And we saw worse fractures in the clothing specimens, because the thing is that any obstacle between when the bullet enters, it causes the bullet to yaw, to spin over the in relation to the vertical axis, and it makes the cavity bigger and the pressures bigger, and the damage is worse. Finally, we also were thinking about bacterial infections, and I always thought that if you shoot a bullet, the bullet is sterile because of the heat caused by the explosion, but that's actually not the case. So we put some bacteria, Streptococcus salivarius, onto the bullet, into the barrel, and onto the leg, and then shot the sheep femurs and tibia, and we found the bacteria everywhere. We found it in the wound, whether it was on the bullet, the barrel, or on the skin. So all those wounds are potentially infected. Now, once the soldiers were injured, what happened to them? Well, they were quite well organized. The military, they always are organized, as we all know. They had quite a number of levels of medical and surgical care. And it started with the regimental aid post, which was basically a first aid, you know. Okay, you got a wound there. Well, it's not a big problem. Clean it, dress it, and off you go back to your trench. Or if it required a bit more attention, they were sent to the advanced dressing station. Either they were walking wounded or they were carried by stretcher bearers. And there was the field ambulance was a mobile medical unit. It was not a vehicle or something like that. And that's where that was 500 meters or kilometer behind the front. And that's where the first place where you could do some surgery, where you could do sort of guillotine amputations and cleaning up wounds under anesthetic. Then the casualty clearing station was a bit more equipped. And then they had some stationary general hospitals. They were further behind the front line. And then if the soldiers required evacuation to the UK, they had hospital ships. And in the UK, they had military and war hospitals. Few photos here, you can see there's stretcher bearers here in a trench. There's a walking wounded. It wasn't easy to get around the trench there with a stretcher. And then there were horse-drawn ambulances here. And of course, you probably know that it was very muddy there in on the Western Front. This is a railway ambulance. These are the dressing stations where you can see they are in dugouts, and they were able to do some surgery. They were obviously given an anesthetic or some pain relief. And you can see it was pretty well organized. That this was, you see there's some Thomas's splints there. There was some breathing sort of respiratory stuff there, anti-tetanus and things like that. So it all looked quite well. They also had railway and barge hospital. And they look also quite well kitted out and quite well organized. These are the field hospitals. And now they were mainly tents, because they had to move quickly when the front was moving. And this is one in Gallipoli and one on Lemnos Island. So it gives you an idea what that looked like. And then in France, there were stationary hospitals. And there was this was in Wisks. There was that was a New Zealand stationary hospital. There were two. There was one in Wisk and one in Hazebrook. This was the Australian stationary hospital, and this was another one I can't remember. And that's the first sort of place where you would find nurses. The nurses were not allowed to be close to the front line. And these are New Zealand nurses who were working at the first New Zealand stationary hospital in France. And in England and the southern part of England, you had all these military hospitals who were looking after the soldiers who were evacuated from France. So there was the first, second, and third New Zealand General Hospital there. I'll come back to that. So they were in sort of barracks, as you can see here. This is the inside of the first New Zealand hospital in Brockenhurst, I think it's, yeah, Brockenhurst. So you can see all these men in traction there. You can see they're all in Thomas's splint in traction. Obviously being shot and either of broken tibia or broken femur. Now I came across this botanic dressing. I thought your nurses would be interested in this. And that was used at the first general hospital in Brockenhurst by New Zealanders. And they used sphagnum moss or peat. And they had the local schoolboys around the hospital to go and collect it from the swamps. The boys were cleaning it and drying it, and they used it as an on the soldier's wound, because apparently it's antiseptic, not sure, but it's very absorbent. It absorbs about 20 times its weight, and so that was better than cotton, and so that, I found that interesting. There were other stationary hospitals. There were some in Egypt here. There were some in Malta as well, because the New Zealanders during the Gallipoli campaign, they were based in Egypt. And then they were being ferried across, and the stationary hospitals were in Egypt. There were some in Malta as well. And then New Zealand had two hospital ships, the Mahino and the Marama, which was fitted out in New Zealand, in Dunedin and in Wellington. And they had some cots for the soldiers who were requiring a bed, and then they had some wards for walking wounded as well. Now I read about this, and it was kitted out in Dunedin and Wellington, and they were talking about how many operating theaters there should be on the boat, and the military said we need two, but then the bureaucrats said no, you can only have one. So things haven't changed, you know. The new Dunedin Hospital is exactly the same what it was about 100 years ago. Right. So now we're coming back to this young man. You can see now he's in a military uniform. So this is Virginia's grandfather, Charlie Piper. And I want to tell you about him because he got injured during the war. So he was born in Oamaru. Christmas Day, 1886. And, you know, initially they were volunteers, but then they ran out of volunteers, and then they introduced conscription, and he was conscripted, and he was enlisted into the Defense Force in the Otago Infantry Battalion in July 1916. And he left towards the end of the war in January 17. And I have his letters he's written during his voyage to Europe. And he was a very good writer, the way he describes everything. He was not allowed to tell in the letter which boat he was on, but by reading it, I got that they stopped in Albany, Western Australia. They stopped in Cape Town and Freetown, Sierra Leone. They did not go via the Suez Canal, probably because it was too dangerous. Because of mines, or also the Turks were on the eastern side of the Suez Canal. And he arrived in March 1917. So you can see it took a while. Now here's his conscription. You can see he was enlisted in July 2016, and he was in the first company of the 10th Otago Infantry Battalion. You can see there. This was his pay book. They were paid 5 shillings a day. And obviously somebody sort of typed all his letters, and it's very interesting reading how he was very good at describing people, describing situations. He was in the canteen on the ship, and he describes when they were in Albany, he described when they were in Cape Town and in in Sierra Leone where they stopped. And he was an artist as well. So he was very good at caricature. So you can see the amazing expression on these people's faces. This is obviously these are sort of two diggers there. I thought that was amazing how his observation and able to describe it and also to draw it. Now, when he arrived in England, he had dysentery, and he's in his letters, he says probably got it in Sierra Leone. And he was admitted in Plymouth. He was admitted to the Third New Zealand General Hospital in Codford in Wiltshire. And that's where most of the New Zealanders were based. I also have his hospital notes. And I understand he had scabies and acute dermatitis at some stage. And then he was sent to the front, the Western Front. And he was based near Etaples in France. And initially he was asked to do trench digging and cable laying. And he was he couldn't keep up with the New Zealand sort of boys like the farmers and the builders who were able to dig really, really fast. So he got quite tired, I think. And he was admitted to the first Australian hospital near Rouen with a diagnosis of PUO. Now, I thought about this for a little while, but I think it means pathology of unknown origin. So he was probably exhausted or something like that. And here was the hospital where he was admitted. This was the first Australian hospital, similar to the New Zealand stationary hospitals. He was also described as suffering from attacked strength. And then, unfortunately, he was a stretcher bearer at some stage, and he suffered a gunshot wound to the right buttock, thigh, and knee in August 1918. And he was admitted to the second Australian General Hospital in Wimmera, and then evacuated to England. And he spent some time at the second New Zealand General Hospital in Walton-on-Thames, and returned on the Marama Hospital ship just before Christmas 1918, so after the end of the war. And this is an envelope of a letter he received, where you can see that he was in the New Zealand New Zealand hospital in Walton upon Thames, as you can see there. And this is a letter written by Sir Thomas Mackenzie, who was the High Commissioner for New Zealand in London. And this is a letter to his parents informing them that he's been shot, but that he's doing well in hospital. And he apologizes that he could not visit him personally. And he was discharged when he was back here, discharged from the army in 1920. And he was wearing a caliper for the rest of his life because he had permanent damage to the sciatic nerve. And he worked as a secretary for the OMRU RSA and died in 1955. This person here, which is basically Buddha, he said that every experience, no matter how bad it seems, holds within it a blessing of some kind. So there were some medical advances during the World War I, and often medical advances have happened during the wars. And I've listed a few here. I mean, the orthopedic people here will know the Thomas splint, to splint and treat fractured femurs. I think the management of open fractures, because a lot of these gunshot wounds were open and infected. Also, the surgeons learned a lot there. And there were no antibiotics, of course, in those days. It was before the time of penicillin. And some second solution, and I think it was a British chemist and a French surgeon worked on this, and that's basically 0.5 sodium hypochloride. It's basically bleach. And interestingly, I worked in Haiti there after the earthquake, and we were using exactly that in theater. Blood transfusion also made some progress, portable x-ray, artificial limbs, and of course, as a result of World War I, orthopedic surgery and plastic surgery was born. And this man here, he said he's the father of orthopedics. Robert Jones, he was a Welsh surgeon, went to University of Liverpool Medical School, and his nephew was Hugh Owen Thomas, where the Thomas splint comes from. And he was the supervisor of all orthopedic hospitals for the Royal Army Medical Corps. And lots of the New Zealand surgeons learned their orthopedic skills from this man, Robert Jones. That's the Thomas splint, which really made a difference to the mortality of the soldiers following fractures of the femur. And we still use it occasionally, certainly when I was working here, there's a child with a fractured femur treated in a Thomas splint. And then prosthetics, they were quite basic at the start of the World War I, and a lot of servicemen lost their legs, and as a result of this stimulated quite a lot of progress as far as prosthetics were concerned. Now, once the war was over, there were all these injured New Zealand soldiers who returned home. And I don't think New Zealand was prepared for that. But they managed to establish some military orthopedic units in New Zealand. And in 1919, 1 year after the end of the war, there were almost 5,000 soldiers undergoing treatment in New Zealand and about 2,000 as inpatients, a lot of them as outpatients, but over almost half as inpatients. And that, of course, decreased over time. And 80% of these injured soldiers needed orthopedic treatment, and they also needed physical therapy. Of course, occupational therapy as well, to get them back into work, vocational retraining, and that was taken over by the Red Cross, who ran workshops. Now, there were a number of military hospitals in New Zealand, and I'm briefly going through those. There was the King George V Orthopaedic Hospital in Rotorua, specifically built for the returning servicemen. A Christchurch hospital had a military part to the hospital. There was Trentham near Upper Hutt. There was a military section here at Dunedin Hospital. There was Queen Mary Hospital in Hamner Springs, also for the veterans. And I think that's where they treated a lot of soldiers who had shell shock. There was a military hospital in Timaru and a military annex in Auckland. Here's a view of the King George Hospital in Rotorua. Interesting, they were all built in this rotunda sort of style. And this was inside the Rotorua Hospital. Interesting design of hospital beds there. This was the old Christchurch Hospital. This was the Trentham Camp Hospital of wood, sort of a villa sort of style, sort of buildings. Dunedin Hospital here, and you probably know this, the central part was from the South Sea exhibition. And Auckland had a military annex here. That was the old Auckland Hospital. This Featherston Camp had a nice hospital, a big hospital. Actually, two, where hospital number 102, they had about 160 bed and operating rooms. And you can see again, open wards, lots of light coming in this round rotunda style. Now, after the war, what did the surgeon have to do? Well, they had a lot of stump revisions because the amputations were often the guillotine type of amputation. There was a lot of patients with chronic post-traumatic osteomyelitis, non-unions. They had to do tendon transfers for nerve injury and plastic surgery. And this man here, James Renfrew Wright, was based here in Dunedin, and he actually had a lot of experience in treating this. He's actually written a book about this, the treatment of chronic osteomyelitis following war fractures. And I come back to him. Amputations, yes, then There were about 1,000 servicemen who had limbs amputated. And there was a need for artificial limb departments. And most military hospitals had such services attached to them. So you can see here, somebody had bilateral below knee amputations with a very simple sort of, there's not even a foot there, there's just a sort of a peg sort of, but he managed to walk on this. This one had an amputation on the left arm. And then there were the maxillofacial injuries, terrible injuries from shrapnel wounds. And there were two people here who were the pioneers of plastic surgery and maxillofacial surgery. Henry Pickerill, he was a British dental, he was dual qualified, dental and medical. And he did quite a lot of reconstructive surgery to the jaw and things like that. And Harold Gillies, he was in Dunedin born, Dunedin educated, went to Wanganui Collegiate School and then went to England. And he was an ENT surgeon. And then he learned a lot of plastic surgery and he invented quite a number of plastic flaps to reconstruct the soldiers' faces, quite famous. And then a number of the surgeons who had learned orthopedics in England came back and they became the first orthopedic surgeons. And there's quite a list there. I can't go through all of them, but I've just talked about James Renfrew White because he was really the surgeon who was attached, who brought orthopedic surgery to Dunedin. So he was born in Dunedin and as a graduate of this university here. And then he went to England before the war to pass his fellowship exam. And he did that in 1914, and then the war broke out. So then he joined the Royal Medical, Army Medical Corps, and he briefly served in France. He worked under Robert Jones, and then he returned in New Zealand in 1918, and he became orthopedic surgeon to the New Zealand Military Forces, the rank of Major, Major White. And he founded the orthopedic department here in Dunedin, and he was also in charge. He also developed the physiotherapy department. Now, coming back to this man here now, because he wrote this book, which inspired me to do this talk. Now, he was English. He was born in Hartford, north of London. He went to the Guy's Medical School and then worked as a house surgeon at Guy's. And then he became a medical officer in Bath, appointed as a balneologist to the Royal Water Hospital in Bath. And he was appointed in 1902 and he came to New Zealand. Now, when his original name was Arthur Stanley Woolman, and he changed his name because that sounded a bit too German. So he changed his name to Herbert, which was his mother's maiden name. And what did he achieve? Well, he managed to get this bathhouse built in Rotorua. You probably all know of now, it's a museum now. And that was his house where he lived, the Woolman House, which is now an art gallery, I think, in a community center. He also wrote a lot on mineral waters and spas in New Zealand. And of course, he wrote this book here. It's part one. He never wrote part two, so I'm not sure what happened there. And basically what he did in here, he looked after a lot of New Zealand soldiers wounded, coming back from the war, and he described mainly the gunshot wounds to the nerves. He did not deal with fractures. He was not a surgeon. He was sort of he became a rehabilitation physician. And he describes all these cases there where soldiers came back with residual paralysis, deformity, and lack of sensation. And then he outlines his experience how to restore the function after the nerve has been damaged, the muscle is paralyzed. And he came up with he describes a number of treatment options. So in those days, there was very little. And because he was working in Rotorua, he used a lot of water-based treatments. So there were the options of, massage was quite common then. Also used electrotherapy, electric treatment, diathermy for deep heat treatment, radiotherapy, bath, and ice and cold water. So he used a lot of electrical treatment, and that was mainly for relief of pain and to maintain muscle function. Now, there are different types of, all our cells, as we know, all our cells are electrically loaded. And in those days, they used this a lot. It's still used a little bit these days, mainly by physiotherapists and physical therapists, I think. And there were two types of currents, the galvanic current and the ferritic current. One was used when the nerve was intact, you used one. When the nerve was not intact, you had to directly stimulate the muscle to prevent muscle wasting. Or if the muscle was wasted, trying to stimulate the muscle electrically so it contracts, so that it recovers bulk and function. Diathermy and radiotherapy for causalgia, which is what they used to call causalgia, is now chronic pain syndrome. I'm not a pain specialist, by the way. This is what they use. This is the ferritic and galvanic battery. The galvanic current was, they were both direct currents. One was a long duration, and the one was of short duration to stimulate the muscle when the nerve was cut. And here you can see some soldiers undergoing that treatment here. Here, I'm not quite sure. I don't think this is electrical stimulation. I wonder whether this is sort of hot air or something like that. I'm not quite sure. Massage was used a lot. And that was basically, they felt that that promoted the local circulation, the nutrition to the muscles, and also to break down adhesions and scarring from the injury. And then there were different types of massage. The water treatment, of course, they were in Rotorua, using the local warm pools in Bath, again, for this tissue softening as a sedative, etc. And here's some example. I think this is sort of a douche, what they call a douche. Douche in French means a shower, where you have sprays of water sort of giving you sort of a water massage. This is you combining the bath with electrotherapy. And then this guy was sort of, Dr. Stanley there was, Dr. Herbert was very much into sort of, he was thinking, how can we restore muscles if they're not functioning? And he came up with some principles, and then he devised some, what he calls artificial muscles. Basically, they were these splints, but so for him to restore the muscle, he took some, sort of basically some, how would I say, this was the tendon was sort of, he replicated the tendon by canvas, and then the muscle part was the elastic part, and then the other end was again canvas. So he said, this is an artificial muscle. So this guy here had a paralysis of biceps. So gravity, the triceps was working and gravity was working. So the soldier was able to extend the elbow and the elastic band was bringing it up. That was his principle. And you can see here, this is why somebody who had a paralysis of the foot with the foot dropping, he used it. The other big problem is because these soldiers were in bed or in plasters for a long time, they often developed articular joint contractures. And then there was a whole range of different ways of dealing with this, and he describes this quite well here. And here is one of those machines, which is like a sort of what we call a CPM machine, a continuous passive motion machine, to get the movement back in the joints. Of course, they didn't have, they had some weights there to give the, for example, here to bend the knee, they put on weights and then gradually the knee was bending. Now, this was an interesting thing, constriction hyperemia or the Beers treatment. They felt that they put a venous tourniquet on, so let the limb swell up. It swells, it becomes all bluish. And then after some time, they let it go. And then when the blood comes back, it causes a hyperemia. So the principle is based on intermittent venous tourniquet followed by arterial hyperemia. And they felt that that would increase the local circulation and lead to healing of the things. And he described a couple of cases here. This was a case, bullet wound from Gallipoli. And you can see here how long these people were in hospital. This one was in hospital from September 16 to February 17. So they got very good treatment. It's got a typical claw from the ulnar lesion, nerve lesion, had a median nerve lesion. And he made these splints, which we still use these days. I mean, they were mainly made from leather and sometimes wood, and then, of course, canvas and elastic things. This was a scapular wound of the right arm at the Somme. Had a radial nerve palsy with a wrist drop and finger drop, and made these amazing splints from leather here, and resting splints there, made from actually aluminium. This guy here was he was shot in the temple, on the temporal side of the head on the left side, and he had a right side of hemiplegia. He had a burr hole, but his hemiplegia didn't recover, so he was fitted out with all these artificial muscles there. And he described what the sutor glove, which was to keep the finger straight and then to prevent contractures. And this is the modern version of this thing. And the case three is in common peroneal nerve injury with a foot drop, and Private Charles Piper probably was wearing a thing like that because he had a sciatic nerve palsy. Occupational therapy, because they had to be able to get back into the workforce. This is interesting. You know what this is? These are corn cobs, okay? Corn cobs, they use that because it allows a good grip. It doesn't slide out of the hand, and use that for the injured soldiers. And here they are taught by the nurses how to sew, as you can see here. So I will conclude. So the sacrifice for New Zealand was amazing. Sort of a population of 1 million, 15,000 soldiers lost their life, and 50,000 were wounded. And then about 40,000 returned injured. You can imagine that how the health system was coping with this. That was a lot of patients. 1,000 had limbs amputated. And then the other thing which happened at the end of the war, it was the influenza pandemic, and another 1,000 soldiers died as a result of that. So I think I've given you an overview of the medical issues related to World War I, and I've shown you that this was the birth of orthopedic surgery, and you know, we all have stories like Charles Piper. I'm sure in your families there were some parents or family members who were injured or killed in the war. So I think we should remember the sacrifice of these young men and women. Thank you very much for listening to my talk. Thank you. No, I think, Terry, we have some time for questions.
Questions.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, the question was, for those online, PUO is not pathology of unknown origin, but pyrexia of unknown origin. So it's good to have a physician to back up the surgeon sometime.
Yes.
I presume from what you see that they've gone out of fashion by the time the First World War.
The question here was during the Napoleon War, they used a lot of maggots to clean up dirty and infected wounds. And the question was, did this go out of fashion? No, I didn't think it went out of fashion. I think they still use it on the vascular ward. So it's still being used at the moment. And I think it is a good way of cleaning wounds. But, you know, if you tell the patient, I'm going to put some maggots in your wound, I'm not sure whether they would be very impressed with your treatment. But yes, it's still being used and it works, yes.
Jean-Claude, there was a rheumatology unit at Rotorua Hospital. Was Herbert's unit part of the same thing, or was it a separate?
Yeah,
unit?
I think
all to do with bones and joints.
Yeah, so he was appointed in 1902. So before the war, he was looking after rheumatology patients, and then when all these soldiers came back, he had to take on that as well. And then, of course, after the Second World War, they built the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. And that also took some soldiers from the Second World War, and that became the rheumatology center of New Zealand, where the people with rheumatoid arthritis were being treated.
Questions? There's no more questions. I'm sure everyone in the audience has just thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed your presentation, Jean-Claude. So thank you so much for
sharing
it with us. Thank you.
Pleasure. Thank you very much. Thank you.